All right, it's just now 7 o'clock. Thank you all for attending this June meeting of the Rollinsford Planning Board. In attendance tonight, we have our ex officio member Denise Knowles, Kevin Haynes. We will appoint Carolyn Kendall as a voting member for the purposes of tonight's meeting. Mr. Krebs, our consultant, is here but currently in the hall, and our secretary, Sarah. So our first order of business is Madeline and William Cambo, 195 Clement Road. Is there someone here to, there's no one here to, okay.
Is the application filed or not?
Yes. Yeah, we'll need yours. I don't know. I think we have a form. Okay, so. I don't see anyone here from the Cambo property, so why don't we move on? Juggle the agenda here a little bit. Mr. Connolly, if you want to, maybe a couple of preliminary consultations you'd like to talk about.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. If the board pleases, and if the chair pleases, in the order that were listed for discussion purposes on your agenda tonight, I believe the Denison matter is A, and B is the Jesse Dome
Correct.
Matter. Yeah. My business partner, Daniel Lynch, is here, and he's prepared to present the Jesse Doe Road site plan preliminary. And if it's okay with the board, could you go
no
first?
No problem at all.
Okay.
Please proceed.
I'm going to say that.
Needs more time to relax.
You need to be able to see this?
I'm going to lay this in the middle of the table here. You can't see it. I told it up. And I have copies of plan here as well. First one over this direction, online. And I'll break it up with the side over here. We're in here for just a preliminary consultation. I'm here on obviously on behalf of Speedway Transportation. If you all travel to the transfer station, you're well aware that C&J has a number of buildings further up at the end of Jesse Doe Road. One of which on your left, as you're about to make the turn to the right into the transfer station, is basically a vehicle storage building for buses. Mr. Jalbert or Rollinsford, what's it called? The Rollinsford Realty Trust purchased the land that we're speaking about tonight in two parcels. This parcel over here actually extends another, it's hard to visualize, but basically towards down about another 10 or 15 inches. That direction, so it's a very long, narrow parcel, primarily composed of wetlands. And then the other parcel is a form of town, piece of town land, located right over in here, kind of a pie-shaped piece right here. So in total, we're looking at a little over 2.1 acres of land. The proposed use is simply another building, similar to the one that's further up the road. The intention here is to store three buses. It's not as long as the other structure. It's 60 feet long, 58 feet wide.
Do you mind swinging that door shut? I'm sorry to interrupt. It's just hard to hear. But...
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
No problem. So the way we've configured this is the primary goal was to get the building positioned so it was not encroaching within the 50-foot wetland buffer. And also, given its specific use, to be able to accommodate the turning radiuses of buses going both in and out. So if a bus is coming in, you can make the turn into the site and go into any of the three bays, and coming out to make the turn right to head back over across the railroad tracks. This is the B&M Railroad here. This is the drive up to the Colonel Albert home, and Jesse Doe Road headed towards, as I mentioned before, the transfer station. So we've positioned the building accordingly, and we've gotten these driveways raised position so that they can accommodate the turning radiuses. We will be asking for a waiver for the driveway width. We had to do a similar waiver request for the other vehicle storage building. Each of these will be 30 feet wide at the right-of-way line. I believe the regulation calls for 18 feet for one-way travel.
Is this one-way, Dana?
Yes, the traffic pattern would be one-way in, one-way out.
Okay.
This parking area here is specifically for the drivers of the vehicles to park their own private vehicles. There is no specific parking category in the regulations for a use such as this. So we focused on what the actual needs of the facility were in order to minimize the amount of pain. And we put in the required one parking space. Essentially, we're keeping it very simple. The building will not have any water or sewer. The only sewer-oriented amenity here would be that we will have trench drains within the building if the buses arrive, either leave in the snow and ice or have been recently washed. Some place for the drippings to run into, and then we're proposing a holding tank at this time. And that holding tank is 1,000 gallons. To be perfectly honest with you, I think most of the time the whatever runoff ends up in the trench drains and pipes will evaporate before it reaches the holding tank. But just in case, that is there to accommodate that need. As far as lighting goes, a similar package of lighting that we used on the other building, which basically are lights over the doorways. And I have a lighting plan in the package, which we will submit. These are LED lights, low power usage. The drainage system will be fairly straightforward. And we've done an analysis already and find that we had no increase in runoff leaving the site. So we basically taken care of handling water quality and left it at that. We will need to get conditional use permits for two encroachments into the wetland buffer. One is a pavement encroachment over here. Right in this area here, we have pavement encroaching into the wetland buffer, about 560 square feet. The way we've graded this and designed it is so that all of the runoff from this pavement area comes back into the site, does not go off the edge and into the wetlands. So everything comes back into the site and is picked up by this catch basin over here. And then we have a slope encroachment because of the grading associated with the slope adjacent to the building and the pavement in this area. We have an encroachment of, again, about 560 square feet into the wetland, 25-foot no disturbance area. So those are the two conditional use permits that we'll be applying for along with this application. I will make contact with the Conservation Commission Chairman and get on one of their agendas. And we're proposing some landscaping. Again, in keeping with what we've done before, we've put some birch trees in here along the roadway. And I've also put a row of evergreens along this section here so that folks coming up into Church Street really don't look into the end of the building here. It kind of creates a little bit of a buffer, so it's a visual buffer more than anything else. That's it in essence. And basically we're here just to see if you have any thoughts or concerns that we can address as we get these plans closer to submission to you for a official review.
Are you concerned at all about visibility from that row of the row closest to me, of trees there for a bus driver?
These right here? No, these are, first of all, you come down to a stop right here.
Yep.
Okay. So our site distance concern here would be back this way, and I've analyzed that, and it's more than adequate. Similarly, site distance for folks coming up the road, if a bus should be stopped and turning in, is more than adequate. So I think we're going to check that
one. There's a nice buffer here, too, for headlights at night.
Questions from the board, Kevin?
Visually, from the outside appearance-wise, is it mimic the other storage building, the much larger storage building, as far as structure, design, color?
I believe so,
because
yes.
Because I find that blends very well for the capacity of the building. So it's very similar to what we've been seeing. And we've already addressed the line of sight issues and no line of sight issues as far as turn and radius. And
the finish seems to chalk a little bit over time, which tends to make it blend with the surroundings. So it's...
It dulls.
Yeah, it seems to be more
flatter gray.
And will these trees you're putting in, will they be planted as somewhat mature trees, or will they be planted as...
I've specified them at a minimum height of 6 inches. They're not arborvitaes, they're different.
Minimum height?
Minimum height of the evergreens would be 6 feet.
And the minimum is 6 inches.
Yeah, you're going all over this.
My cut back, we can make it a foot. No, I'm sorry, 6 feet. And these are, I was thinking of the caliper, these, I think it's 2.5 inch caliper, so they're established trees.
I think those birch trees look kind of nice down along the street there.
Caroline, you
have a comment? You mentioned, I'm not sure if you said storm drain or catch basin, but that looks like, is that to be a an installed pit with like riprap, or is that like a storm drain to enter into the town storm drainage system?
It's what it is there, we have,
Dana mentioned two.
Yes.
He mentioned the one side of the building, which is more of a floor drain.
These right, with a tank. I understood that to be the storage tank.
The bottom side is stormwater oriented, and what we're doing is picking up stormwater here in the catch basin and conveying it out through an outlet here out into the...
Like a dry well.
No, not a dry well, like a discharge from...
Catch basin we see on the street with a grate, and it has a 3 foot...
Okay, so then culvert, okay, and then into there.
And then it discharges here, then it'll just blend in.
The catch basins have, as Paul just mentioned, 3 foot stumps.
Yeah.
So your sand and grit right. Tend to settle out there, and they also have hoods on them,
yeah.
So that anything that floats doesn't migrate out of the pipe.
Oils or that type of thing. They stay in the basin and not float out into the environment. So they have to be pumped periodically.
Yeah, they have to be cleaned
out. Which they do because they have a oil grit separator down at the number one building, where all the maintenance happens. So while the likes of Enpro or Clean Harbors is here, they just dip into the old
right. We do that annually in town, and I guess my only thought about that is I'm not sure that we have other catch basins in town that don't go into the system of outfalls that ultimately end up in one of the brooks or rivers in town. So you're just adding a different kind of structure that, you know, filters out differently, and I don't have any comments about that. I'm just kind of noting it.
It's similar in some ways in that I'm sure most of the town basins have sumps, but yeah. I got a hunch that none of the town basins have hoods on them. Been using hoods for the past 10, 15 years.
Yeah.
It's a nice add-on. It's fairly short-lived.
But it's not adding any more burden. This doesn't go water runoff. That the town has to deal with as well coming around Jesse Doe.
These catch basins are all
the end, adding more down to the end.
Okay, so you're privately emptying your catch basins.
Oh, yeah.
They're all located within the lot itself, not
okay.
Out of the street.
Okay.
We will be picking up a little bit of runoff from this edge of the street, but we designed it to.
Great. Goes into the lot.
Goes into the lot.
So we don't shed anything onto the street.
It's a fairly compact and very self-contained development. We're really impacting a very small portion of the whole 2.1 acres.
And this is all junk.
Yeah, it really is. On the cover sheet there, we have a little over an acre, 55,000 square feet of wetlands, and almost an acre of uplands.
Is there good land out here, Dan, or is that all
wet? No, it's all wet. My intention in putting this plan on the cover is to show the relationship. This is the building that's been there for about 7 or 8 years now. And this is the building we're proposing now.
What's this? That's a separate lot of record right here.
That's the peat parcel that Gilbert bought in January of 2017 from St. Hilaire.
Right, that would be this piece right here.
And then the pie-shaped piece he bought from the town closed on that in April of 2017.
This right here is not That's a separate lot of record.
No, no, no. Don't let this line confuse you. I'm sorry. What this is a box around the area. It says CPL.
So this is good viable land here.
No, that is wetland.
That's all wetland.
It's from here.
Oh, this is upland right here. That upland right there.
Yeah, that's that little.
That's this thing. Okay, okay. I was on the wrong side of the line.
So here to here is all wetland.
Got it. Yep.
Are you proposing to merge these two?
Yes.
These two would be merged, yes.
We'll come in with a lot merger form at the same time with submitting the site plan review application and the conditional use permit application. Just do it all in one fell swoop.
So that's the intended clarification, which evidently didn't work out.
Dan, as long as you're holding it up,
sure.
Why are you flaring this out so much?
Because so that the bus does not have to swing out into oncoming traffic to make that turn.
They're going to come from both directions.
Right.
Oh, okay.
More often, they're going to come from this direction, John, because they're going to come back from service, get washed, get serviced, and then come back to be put away to bed at night in the barn.
And you cannot move these spaces over here.
We looked at.
I looked at a lot of different combinations that seem to make the most sense, given the amount of land that we have over here before we hit the right of way. Also, there's a. We push this over to as close to the property line as we possibly can, still get a slope.
Okay. Is this a 12 and a half foot setback to pavement, which is exactly one half foot setback in the industrial zone? We wanted to keep any parking spaces out of the front yard just for visual aesthetic reasons, you know.
Yeah.
I don't think we have any parking in the front yards at any of the three buildings right now. This looks nice.
There's an occasional used car for sale on the lawn there, but hasn't been one for a long time. Kevin, did you?
You did say that there's going to be no running, no sewer or water. There's no restroom at this facility.
Correct.
It's purely drivers will park their personal vehicles on the outer apron, get into a bus that was already pre-serviced the night before, and leave directly.
Exactly.
Correct. So there's no running. There's no bathroom. There's no facilities at all.
No.
It's purely storage. Okay.
Anyone else have a question, comment?
That's all the questions we wanted to set forth before the board.
Yeah. We will submit this. I would presume this would be sent out for peer review or engineering review, or what's the board's position on that?
Yeah, that's what we usually do, right?
Yeah, but what is your schedule?
We would like to get this through the process as efficiently as possible.
Typically the board, if someone's in a real hurry, I'll ask the chair if we can send this to the town engineer for review in advance of the meeting. If you want to wait and ask the board, you can ask the board right now if they're going to ask for a peer review. If they are, you can get it over to civil consultants now and have them review it. Otherwise, you can wait for a meeting and ask the board then.
Right. I just soon get it over to them if it's acceptable to the board.
What do you guys think? I think that's the precedent we've been following. And I think where we've got...
Well, there are a few waivers of the asking for, nothing outstanding. I think that would be the typical course that we follow on the next meeting.
Yep.
Send it to review.
So if you want to compress the schedule, I can get it over to Jay right now.
Sure.
As soon as you have a complete set of...
Since we have it all set, and we can also schedule our appearance before the Conservation Commission.
Yeah. Drainage report is published.
Drainage report is completed. Yeah, the applications are essentially completed. I'm just going to recheck the abutters list because it's been a couple of months. But other than that.
Speaking of applications, we've taken the liberty of making a word-based platform of your Form A for town subdivision. Would you like a copy of that? I just keep, mimeograph in the night. The
it's
one
starting to get real fuzzy.
19 space to fill in the year, and I think, well, we're in 2018 now.
That would be wonderful.
Okay,
if you would
I'll send it along
to
both
you.
Of your email addresses, and it'll be in a Word document.
Excellent, thank you.
Other than that, I don't have any questions. I think I've got a good co-chair in the process. So really good too.
Excellent. That's good. Thank you.
Thank you. Appreciate you coming.
Thank you very much.
On lot number one behind them. And that
they'd like to do is do a lot line adjustment and an even land swap between lot number one and lot number two, about 9,500 square feet, or about 0.2 acres, give or take. So at face value, that would seem pretty simple, right? Just an even swap. Well, nothing's ever really simple anymore. So what I've done is drawn up just a one-page list of what I see as potential, not hurdles, but just topics we need to discuss and perhaps we can get a better idea of where we should go next. So what we did over the past couple months is we proceeded to do a more detailed survey of existing conditions showing topography, wetlands, slopes, existing house and garage built by Phil back in '85 on the parcel. And as you can see on lot 7-3, which is lot 1 on the subdivision plan, there are wetlands back there. And you can also see on lot 7-3 and 7-4, there are steep slopes. Steep slopes pursuant to your zoning ordinance, which says anything with a slope of 25% or more is steep. Okay, those are shown in shaded areas on the plan. The reason I bring this up is twofold, or multifold actually. One is that back in 1980, none of this made any difference. Okay, but more recently, I think in the 2000s, amendments were made to the zoning ordinance that said that in this zone, the country residential zone, you have to have a 2-acre minimum lot size, but that 2-acre minimum lot size has to be a minimum net 2 acres, free of steep slopes, free of wetlands, free of easements that otherwise encumber that net 2 acres. So obviously we can't do that here because first of all, these lots were created before that zoning amendment. And second of all, we've got steep slopes in the vicinity of where we want to do the swap. So if we could swap 9,500 square feet of land, even Stephen, between the two, and both had the same amount of steep slopes and the not so steep slopes, I wouldn't be asking this question. But there's really no way to do that. And parcel A, as shown here on, of that 9,500 square foot, about half of that is steep slope. Not real steep, but just a little bit steeper than 25%. On lot B, it's equal size counterpart, there are no steep slopes. So if we were to swap this as shown by the proposed red new lot line, in essence, lot 7-3 would become a little bit more confining, conforming in a net sense, and lot number 7-4 would become a little bit less conforming in a net sense, because it would have a little bit more steep slopes, and lot 7-3 would have a little bit less steep slopes. So, I'm wondering, because of all these facts, if we need to go to the zoning board of adjustment and acquire a variance to do this simple even Steven lot swap, which will end up in a gross 2-acre lot for each lot, lot 1 and lot 2, or 7-3 and 7-4, but not in that sense. There's no way we can make either lot net 2 acres without steep slopes, wetlands, or other encumbrances. That's the first zoning question. The second zoning question is that if you can see the existing house that Phil and Bonnie live in up close to Bear Road, you'll note that a very tiny portion of the garage, maybe a foot or two, and a small portion of the house is over the 50-foot setbacks. 50-foot setback from Bear Road, and you also have to respect the 50-foot setback from Fresh Creek Road. The cure for that would also be a visit to the Zoning Board of Adjustment, not for a variance, but for an equitable waiver of dimensional request. Take care of that at the same time. it's existed for 33 years. Just throw that out there. So those are our first two zoning questions. The next questions or topics for discussion is relative to Fresh Creek Road, because Phil wants to build on it, those two conditions of approval that went all the way back to 1980 come into play. And safe to say right now, Fresh Creek Road is a class 6 highway subject to gates and bars, which is, there is no gate, there is no bar there physically, but that's a virtual gates and bars. I already recited the stand of the conditions placed on that plan. Phil is presuming approval of the zoning board issues and the planning board lot line adjustment. Phil is prepared to improve approximately 480 feet of Fresh Creek Road and bring it up to acceptable town standards. And then we have the gates and bars. So I don't know if we can go one of two ways. I'm going to throw it out there for discussion. One would be to request at town meeting that 480 feet of Fresh Creek Road, the first 480 feet, be taken out of
Class 6 status.
I don't know.
Subject to gates and bars.
Move the gates and bars.
Gates and bars.
Or say move the gates and bars.
Or change the class to Class 5. I don't know.
Well, that's one point, John, but on the other end of things, Phil doesn't want to necessarily impart the
Class 5 rights.
No, the Class 5 maintenance requirements onto the town. He's willing to plow it, maintain it, keep it up, pave it, you know, bring it up to standards. But, you know, if there is an adjustment that can be made to that condition of 1980, where it says instead of removing the gates and bars, just allowing the improved road to remain as Class 6 status, understanding that the gates and bars will be 480 feet back, virtual gates and bars, that's okay. I mean, again, we go either way, but we don't want to impart that maintenance and that cost on the town.
Can I interject a question?
Sure.
John, I don't know if you would know this, but if that's the condition of the original subdivision, how much flexibility do we have in present to revise, you know, conditions of an old subdivision? Do we have that authority?
I think we have that authority. I think you need to be careful. You know, I mean, I wasn't around 35 years ago. But I think this board would put the same conditions on it anyway. So I don't think your opinion is going to change as to how, you know, what has to happen with this road. But it might be a question run by your attorney. But I think you have, you know, you. A subdivision can be approved, and 2 years later, so they can come. Someone can come back to the board and ask to have something modified. And I think you have that right. Okay. But I think your opinion would be the exact same as the board in 1980, whatever it was, 85 or 81.
Just as a matter of life safety, we would design the driveway into the proposed house such that it could also act as the hammerhead, if you will, to be wide enough for, with that ample turns for emergency response vehicles to turn there instead of having to build a loop cul-de-sac or a turnaround elsewhere. I mean, the driveway is going to be there anyway, so it can serve that purpose.
I had a question. Because we dealt with issues like this in the last year regarding another Class 6 road, and as I'm hearing, it's not a problem on the property owners at this point to upgrade that to standards, which we can discuss at a later date, obviously, to be for life safety. My question c- concerns more on this back link here. That's still part of an Emerson estate, this larger parent parcel back here.
This board recently, I say recently, within the past couple of years.
I'm just thinking a future down the line of what else pops up on this road.
Right.
But that's where I'm going, Paul.
Yeah. Right. So a couple of years ago, this board approved the Colella subdivision that created the large, it's like a 33-acre parcel on
I heard that.
To which the Buxton, I don't know if that's their name, but this gentleman was a headmaster over at the St. Paul's School and has built a house right, you know, somewhat close proximity to Vinnie Colella's house down there on the land that he sold, that Vinnie sold to this gentleman. And I think they're living in it now. So that big parcel abuts all of Phil's lot 7S3, as well as a good deal of the frontage of Fresh Creek Road down beyond Phil's lot 7S3.
Down to the actual creek, and I think.
Yeah, I don't know if, no, I shouldn't be guessing at this. I have the plan with me. It was done by Ambit Survey. Yeah, there it is. It was so big they had to do it. Oh, they basically split the Colella parcel into two different pieces. This is the Colella house, you know, big colonial house down there at the end of Old Mill Lane. And then they created this, it's a 35-acre parcel here.
And it's all conservation, isn't that right?
Exactly. The shaded area is all conservation
yep.
area. So to answer your question, from here down to the creek, you couldn't build on that side of the road anyway. So the next question becomes on the Q side, and that's current use land, so I can't speak to what Dan and Sally's plans are for the future. Dan and Sally have owned that land now for 32 years, I believe. They bought it off of the Franklin Estate. Yeah. And the items under topic three, Fresh Creek Road, I mean, I just wanted to identify them tonight. Certainly, if you have input, we're not looking to solve any matters tonight. We just wanted to hear what the board's thoughts were. And if I took the temperature of the board, I'm thinking that our next step would be to go to the Zoning Board of Adjustment.
I think that's the next logical step. I'm interested to hear what John thinks.
I think it's ridiculous to go to the Zoning Board, but there's no way around it. I mean, sadly, these ordinances, well, not sadly, I think these are good ordinances. They weren't around in 1985 or 81 whenever the subdivision was approved. So there's no way you can approve this lot line adjustment without zoning relief. So mm-hmm. you got to go. And you got to go anyway for the house. So, and as Paul said, there's no way you can change this to get 2 acres of viable upland without steep slopes. It's not going to happen.
We could leave it the way it is, but I mean, we'd end up back here asking for conditional use permits to build on steep slopes and all that. And Phil and Bonnie would prefer to build on a flatter, if you will, portion of the land,
right,
which could be achieved by a lot line adjustment.
And then it's another 90 feet of pavement, and then it looks like there's the road dips down.
It does. It did.
Precisely.
Yeah.
It dips a little shot after that.
But the gates and bars would have to be addressed as well. That's
a selectman issue.
That's going for a town.
I think it does. I don't think the Board of Selectmen in Rawlinsford have the authority to change that. But I could
move it back.
It's a question for the selectmen. I don't know. I'm pretty sure they don't have the. I don't think they have the authority here.
But I don't think we can make any action on it without knowing that clarification either. Just simply because of
the condition still applies. The 1980 condition still applies that they can't get a building permit, they can't build on it until the gates and bars issue is resolved and this is brought up to class five town road standards. So,
to sort of address the fact of the net buildable.
Yep.
The net lot size.
That's right.
You swap good land for bad land, and it's kind of understand that.
This is a three or four step process. You know, zoning board, planning board, board of selectmen, probably town meeting. So it's not going to happen this quickly.
Could I ask a clarifying question?
Please.
Lot one, if you were to achieve this lot line adjustment, it's no longer a grandfathered old lot, so you would still require a variance from the net lot uses. I'm just trying to clarify that point because I feel like we're dancing around that. But do you, you know, that doesn't really qualify as a buildable lot with a minimum lot net 2 acres, as you spoke to.
I think it does, because then it falls under non-conforming lots of record.
Is it still non-conforming when you've done the lot line adjustment?
Yeah, it's the same size.
Well, it's the same size, but you've made that adjustment, though.
But the net 2 acres.
No.
The net's actually better at that point.
Better for this lot, worse for this lot.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But you've altered the grandfather's status.
That's my point. The variance will work.
It's non-conforming because it's conforming to begin with.
Well, neither of them.
Buildable, I guess, yeah. And, you know.
The variance will address that. I mean, I agree. You can't go and we can't do this because it's yes, they're grandfathered today. We start moving these lot lines. They're not going to. They need a variance, and the variance will remedy that problem.
It will allow that, but you know, isn't that another specific issue on top of that to allow it to be buildable, or am I confusing the issue?
Well, it's buildable. This lot's buildable now. I'm assuming if Phil could get if he could address the class 5 gates and bars issue, he could get a building permit as lot because he could get a septic system designed. I don't.
But you need the 2 acres net. He's got 2 acres gross.
But it's a grandfather.
Because of it.
Also remind the board, lot one, lot 7 S Street has been taxed as a buildable lot for the past 38 years.
That's why he sold it to me. He's sick of being taxed. It wasn't German Goose or anything.
The valuation was lower than your typical paved road frontage lot, but it wasn't like the valuation that current use land, that's for sure.
No. Can I just throw something crazy onto the board?
I like crazy.
So one of the things Rollinsford doesn't have a lot of Class 6 roads, so I don't know what you think about Fresh Creek, but Miles and I talked to and Mike, who's not here, talked to a developer that was interested in developing the McHugh parcel. It never went anywhere. So the question I guess I have is if does the board want to see this road upgraded? And is there another solution? And I don't even know if Phil would be game, you know, or this would even work, but could you build a driveway through here and get a variance for that? My only concern is that you upgrade this to Class 5 road standards. Now all of a sudden you've got more lots available here. You got the ability to summon them, extend them even further. And again, it's a policy decision. I'm only saying, you know, we've got a lot here. I'd almost rather say, let's modify this, put a driveway through here, and prevent this from happening. But it's just, again, it may be a cockamamie idea. Because I hate opening up this land to development if it doesn't necessarily need to.
Last fall, they said you build up to 600 feet with a private driveway worth one lot.
Right, that's...
That the town approved.
Right. That's pursuant to the highway book, the road book that published at the state level, the general guidelines being 600 feet, which we're well under with this. To answer your question, that was, if I didn't state it as such, my fault, but I was heading into the not changing it to a Class 5 highway situation, rather keeping it Class 6, such that A, the responsibility for maintenance and cost and everything is still on Phil, and B, because of that, nobody else can come to play unless they, you know, can get all their approvals and...
Well, but this condition is a little, I will admit, it's a little weird. road is brought up to acceptable town standards. Well, what the hell is acceptable? Does that mean, I think it's town standard. That means it's class five.
18 foot wide.
And that means it's class five.
It opens it right up.
It opens it up.
Not necessarily. It could be, it could look like a class five, but it's not necessarily a class five. In other words, it could.
I'm just trying to, this is really a policy decision for either this board or the Board of Selectmen, but I think it has the potential of opening up land that, you know, isn't available for development today. That's all I'm saying.
And it's
on Phil's dime.
Phil would rather do a 12-foot gravel driveway, okay?
And I'm just saying, does it have to be in this right-of-way? Can it be somewhere else? I'd rather see, if you got to go to the zoning board anyway, how about getting a variance for not having frontage and just and putting a driveway?
Yeah.
It's just a thought, Paul. If there was class six roads throughout this town, and we dealt with this issue before, it'd be different. But we don't have many. And this is pretty nice land.
Yeah.
One of my concerns is at the end of the road is to put a couple parking spaces for the people to go hunting and stuff, so they don't block me in trying to get out. So I might have put up a sign or something, and a couple of extra parking spaces at the end of it.
So that's why we've extended it about 100 and.
Because there's a lot of people still hunting down there and in pack there.
So it's showing proposed pave about 120 feet beyond your driveway.
Yeah.
We would have to put up some signs so they don't block the driveway. And the reason we did that is pursuant to your zoning, we would need pavement, acceptable town road standards, in front of at least the equivalent frontage, yeah. 180 feet. In this zone, in front of the lot 7-3.
But you've created, now with 400 and some of feet, we've created two lots here. On his dime. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Which is cool. I'm not saying it's bad.
Only if they're allowed to subdivide and they're allowed to enter the hold harmless agreement and the maintenance sharing.
Sure, absolutely. Yeah.
But I think John brings up a good point that no matter what you call that section, once you upgrade it, you're doing half or more of the work for this whole side of the street to, you know, do the next half of the work or have the same exceptions made to have that whole 30 or 40 or 75, I don't know, 55 acres. You know, I think we're sitting ducks with that.
Your point is well taken, and I think you're right as long as they are allowed into the given an invite to the party. Yeah.
And I think that's the invite.
Yeah, at that point, it's still a public way, right?
It's a public way today.
It's a public way today.
If they upgrade to class, Paul's right. I mean, we're all dancing around. You know, if he upgrades it to class five, the time the selectman could keep it a class six to say, you know, but someone could push. You know, it's sort of the entree into this piece here.
What's the standard width
for 50 trips, car trips per day or less, 18 feet of pavement, 2 foot shoulders. That's in the green book.
Greenview. I think Greenview is the same standard, right?
Greenview, no, that's actually 28. Oh. Yeah, that's industrial.
Oh, sorry. Yeah.
Well, I'm saying if they tried to put a subdivision in, you would have to widen.
For the additional traffic,
right.
So he brings up a good point.
They couldn't get a variance.
Right. Your basic your residential house lot brings 10 trips per day to the table. So the point you get to three, well, if you subdivide out two and you got remaining land, that's three. Plus two on this side, the Phil's existing lot and the Marston lot, you're going over 50, and that brings you up to a whole new set of standards. So, good point. That's a good point.
And to that point, I'm wondering what you're talking about setbacks here to Fresh Creek Road. If you're going to upgrade to town standards, we wouldn't want to. Um, debilitate the town's ability to make it a Class 5 someday should they want to. So, you know, I would think that there would have to be some deeding of property to make a proper right-of-way for whatever its potential could one day be.
Precisely. We're going to let that happen on the other side of Fresh Creek Road.
What was the right-of-way now?
It varies from 32 feet
to 40. Not 50.
It's not 50. No. You see what I'm saying? So we're not providing the total enable here. If McHugh wants to come in, he's going to have to deed in a strip and do more improvements.
But and we're talking about the future too, and what could develop. That could happen anyways, though.
Sure. I mean,
that could happen regardless if this goes nowhere. Owners along the other side of the street could certainly propose a plan as well.
Same.
Yep.
Everybody has a right.
Yes,
with their property.
To
develop. That's a great point. To get back to your point about non-conforming lots, zoning ordinance addresses that, and it says the following principles control lots that do not conform to the current provisions of the ordinance. It goes on to talk about the C1 and OSD zone, so I'm going to skip over that. Then I'm going to go to the provisions. It says no action shall be permitted to change the boundary of the lot unless it brings the lot closer to conforming to the requirements of the ordinance and it makes no other aspect of the lot or structures on the lot more conforming. It should say less conforming.
Yes.
No, it says more non-conforming.
More non-conforming, yes.
So, to that end, and as we just discussed, we need to go to the ZBA. Okay?
Yep.
Because...
That'll cure that.
Yeah, that'll cure that. Second item is that no new structures shall be permitted on non-conforming lots only if all the following conditions are met in addition to the requirements of Section 11.3.2 of the ordinance. I have to go back to that, but... And they are a sanitary water supply and sewage disposal are provided. We can do that. We have enough well radius to protect the proposed well, and we have an area for a septic system. And B, the proposed structure meets all setback requirements. Those are shown on the plan because we wanted to make sure our adjusted area would accommodate the ranch house back there, which it will. And it goes on to say in number three, if the conditions of sections 542B cannot be met, that's what we were just talking about, but we don't need to go there because we can meet them. So bottom line is it allows for building on a non-conforming lot. And in this case, as John said, also we go to the zoning board of adjustment that cures the other issues about building on. Simple lot line adjustment. I don't mean to throw an awful lot of questions out at you.
That's some very interesting points. This will be a learning experience.
You like to challenge us. So yeah, I think your next stop is the ZBA. I don't think there's any way around that.
Part of our reason too, in all honesty, of coming here tonight is that we didn't want to go to the ZBA first. I mean, we wanted this board to see it, to know that it's out there, and because you'll know it's out there once there's a notice posted by the ZBA. So
right.
At least let's say you're advised.
I appreciate that.
Thank you very much for your time and.
You know, also might, you know, and I think it also might be smart to go to meet with the Board of Selectmen and ask, at least get that question answered, who has the authority to change the gates and bars restriction?
I think the last time this came up, it was, the answer was at town meeting,
Town meeting
right?
only?
I think.
The same incident
yeah,
well, right.
That's what I'm thinking.
Yeah. But there was a difference in the town reports about the named Class 6 roads.
Oh.
And that, I think, is a difference between the two cases, because I believe that there was trouble finding Shady Lane, but Fresh Creek was listed. And I'm not entirely sure about that, but I think that may be a notable difference.
And certainly we can talk to the select board in general terms and more specific terms
also relative to what their preference might be. In other words, would they rather see the gates and bars condition left in place, or at least the status left in place, but a modification, say, to condition one of the 1980 approval, which might say no building shall be erected on this lot until town, the select board allows for sand, whatever, instead of the language about the gates and bars. Again, we're not opposed to the upgrade, but we're not pushing it.
Yeah. What's the ordinance, the impervial surface MS4?
MS4. I'm not sure how much that pertains to this, but the select board at this time is discouraging the beginning section of Shady Lane from being paved because we're an MS4 community, which means that our storm water is regulated by the state and federal government because we're on the river.
Right.
So the select board, at least in that case, preferred not paving. I can't speak to what they would prefer to here, but also they have final discretion with whether or not to allow building on Classics Road regardless. And so, you know, although the board changes every year or potentially changes every year, you might, you know, ask them how they feel about that. Though they'll never box themselves in, but you can get a feeling.
Well, that's great. Great idea. Thank you very much.
You got anything easy you want to talk about?
That's why I had David go first.
It's hard to believe that I've ever created that lot. Why?
I was wondering the same thing.
I'm surprised the planning board even created that lot. So pretty much.
Do you want to keep one of these for your file? You're welcome to keep two if you want.
I'll keep one. Since I have a personal interest. And of course, I'll have to recuse myself. It's a good thing.
Alright, I'm gonna take one back if that's okay.
Yeah. And, I'll call it for you.
Again, thank you very much for your time and also for the time that Jesse Dover over. I think that can be a good addition to the true part there. Probably more so than anyone ever envisioned. But to get that little bit of extra use out of that area over there. So thank you.
That's not who was at the hall before.
Oh, I heard it.
No, this one's right. I hope they weren't discouraged when we closed the door. Just couldn't hear.
The door wasn't locked outside, I don't think. That was
this way, brother. Thank you.
Thanks. Take care. See you, Mr. Diane.
Approval of the minutes is going to have to wait. This time around. Correspondence, there was none. And any additional business to come before the board?
No? No? And just to be sure, to be clear, we are meeting on the 10th?
Yes. Yep. I heard back from almost everyone that the 3rd wasn't good. I think I'm the only one who would actually show up. So, all right. Was there anything else to come before the board? I didn't hear any. All right. With that, I would entertain a motion to adjourn.
I'll